Hi everyone, Don Smith with TV35. Today we are here at the Cranford Firehouse in our series of emergency management videos that we've been bringing to you here on TV35, our YouTube channel, and our Cranford Township website and the emergency management website. Joining us here today is Lieutenant Carmen Giordino. Lieutenant, nice for you to join us today.
Yeah, how are you?
Very good. So today we're going to be talking about emergency preparations in your home for any type of storm-related issues, be it flooding, or it could be wind, it could be potential hurricane, it could be just a rainstorm. There's a lot of things that go in to keeping yourself safe and keeping your personal effects safe, your property safe, your family safe, your pets. So we're going to go inside and we're going to have a little conversation about, you know, what the best idea is to kind of protect your valuables or kind of tie things down or things not to do where you see either a wire down or if there is some flooding, on some tips on how to keep yourself and your family safe.
Sounds good. Let's do it.
Lieutenant, there are so many different emergencies that could arise. Let's touch on first natural disasters, flooding. Cranford, we've had issues obviously in the past years with flooding. We have, you know, hurricanes, wind damage. Let's start with flooding. So if there is an alert that goes out that flooding is imminent for my neighborhood, my street, what are some of the first things that you would recommend that the homeowner does?
All right, so you want to, hopefully you have a designated area where you keep all your personal belongings. So hopefully they're in a bin. If they're not, you know, you are alerted that there is a threat of a flood or a storm coming through. You want to get that to a higher level in your home if possible. If not, you want them in a go bag where you can get those valuables out of there if you have to, you know, evacuate.
So it'll be something either if you have stuff in a safe, obviously a safe is pretty heavy to move, but
yeah.
if it's a portable one, you suggest to get that up to a second level and get some of your other valuables if you have them in plastic bins or whatever.
Correct.
It's probably the best idea is probably keep a lot of the stuff in plastic bins,
yep.
I imagine, right?
Yeah, keep everything together so you're not fumbling around, you know, grabbing miscellaneous, you know, items. It's one bin, all the valuables right there.
Right.
You bring them to a second floor.
So it's almost like a to-go bag, but if you know, if there's certain things that you know that could be in harm's way, that, like you said, just have it all ready to go, and then as soon as that alert comes out, you move it on up to the second floor or third floor in some cases.
Yep.
Some of the homes have, you know, third floors. So, Lieutenant, having that go bag, I think, is real critical, correct? To have something that you can just grab your valuables and get those to a higher location without you kind of having to think about it. So those are the things that, you know, as our OEM coordinator, Captain Matt Nazaro, says on, you know, blue sky days, those are the kind of things that you want to think about, not when 2 hours that it's going to be potentially 6 inches of water.
Correct.
Yep. So we've secured the valuables. Now, you mentioned something as we walked in from outside the firehouse about, okay, so if we have to evacuate, well, where are we going to go? Talk to me about that and getting that information, let's say the location, to either loved ones or to the fire department, to the police department, so if something does happen to your home, that they're able to get in touch with you.
Yeah, so you should have a place to go to, whether it's going to be a local shelter in place, whether it's in the community center, Orange Avenue School, wherever the shelter is going to be posted. Other option too is maybe a friend or family who lives out of the area, you know, but this should all be planned and coordinated prior to a storm happening or a threat of a flood. Mm-hmm. You want to have a plan.
Yeah, and again, that blue sky day is very important, and it was really interesting the way Captain Zero put that, because you just don't think about things like that until, you know, everybody, I think, just kind of puts things off to the last minute. Have that plan in place. You know, when I was a kid, the fire department, you know, the team that was long, long ago, not going to mention how many years ago, but, you know, they would come to the schools and say, hey, look, you know, you need to have an escape plan out of the house and then have a meeting point as far as meet your parents or your neighbors and whatnot. So it's a safe space, so everybody knows that you're out of the home if there is a fire. Let's talk to everybody about if flooding is imminent, are there things that we should try to do in the home or just get ourselves out, or what would you recommend?
Yeah, I mean, it depends at what stage of the flood or storm this
Sure.
is. You know, if in advance, you know, you want to secure all your lawn furniture, stuff that you might lose. The other thing too is getting your vehicle to high grounds, you know, because it doesn't take much water for water to stall your vehicle. You know, about 6 inches of water could cause you to lose control of your vehicle and even stall it. 1 to 2 feet of water might actually take your vehicle away if the, mm-hmm. the current's strong enough.
And it's amazing, 6 inches of water. I mean, when you say 6 inches of water, you're thinking, ah, it's really not a lot. But I mean, obviously it's a concentrated area all across your entire yeah. street, your driveway, and that can make, you know, a challenge for some of the lower vehicles that are out there yeah. today to get them out of the way if the water is already surrounding your vehicle at that
Correct.
Point.
Correct, yep.
So, Lieutenant, I was here for Hurricane Irene, and the flooding along South Avenue was just, you know, catastrophic, as we all know, some of the results of some of the businesses, unfortunately. But there were many vehicles that were parked along South Avenue, and they began to start to float because I was doing a lot of the video. So, like you said, get those vehicles out of the way because, one, for the vehicle safety, and two, also for your response time.
Yes.
Because if the cars are starting to float, and could be in the middle of the street, you may not be able to get one of your trucks down for another emergency that needs the apparatus that's on this vehicle.
Yeah. Yeah, so we have a boat that, you know, we will respond out into if you are, you know, stuck in your vehicle in water. If you can safely get out of the vehicle, we would encourage that. You don't want to be stranded in the vehicle if water is rising, if there is especially to even a swift water or current. You don't want to be swept away in that vehicle. If you can safely get out of the vehicle, either stay on the hood or the roof of the car, we will come to you if you're not comfortable or not able to get out of that water. We will get to you via our boat and remove you from that dangerous situation.
And I remember during Irene up along Springfield Avenue up by Dryers Farm, there was a couple of cars that got stranded, and the folks, the drivers, did exactly what you said. They were standing on the hood, and then the water was coming up so fast, they actually are on top of the roof, and one of them was actually a pickup truck. So you can imagine how high that water was getting. It was probably a good 4 feet, 5 feet at that point, and that was really one of the ways that the fire department actually spotted him, because I was traveling with you guys getting some video during Irene. So now when a Nixle alert goes out, I know you were telling me that it's real important to pay attention to what that is saying. You know, when the officials say it's time to get out, heed those warnings and get that prep done or, you know, get yourself out of your home.
Yeah, yeah, you need to take these alerts seriously. You know, if flooding is imminent, you know, you should move your car as soon as possible to high grounds, park it legally in town, but you want to make sure you have a full tank of fuel. You know, it might be a little while before you can get gas, but you do want to take these alerts serious, even when it comes to evacuating your home. If the local officials are encouraging to evacuate or ordering you to evacuate your home, it's for your own safety. As the storms intensify, the flooding gets worse, we might be delayed to get you out of your home when it gets to a certain point where now you decide you need to leave your home. So once you're made aware that you should evacuate the area, please take these, very seriously.
And when you do evacuate, getting back to my example with Irene, because I remember being here along South Avenue, and there were a number of people who were walking through the water. That's not a great idea either. You want to make sure you're on dry ground because you're not sure what's in the water, first of all, what kind of water it is, and second of all, there's tons of other hazards that are potential being hidden from you because of so much water on the road. So, Lieutenant, bringing those ideas about the manhole covers are really good information for a lot of folks. Again, that's something I would never have thought of. Now, when we've seen flooding in the past here in Cranford, we've also seen some folks trying to get out and recreate out in it, either using a canoe, a kayak, or, you know, other swimming and that kind of stuff. Tell us why that is not a good idea.
Yeah, so the water is very contaminated, right? There could be, you know, possibility of sewage in there, mm-hmm. Health hazards that if the water is contaminated. Definitely not something you want to be swimming in. It's not a clean body of water.
Right.
You're really putting yourself to potential health issues mm-hmm. If you're swimming in that water.
Yeah.
And it's dangerous, too, because if there is a current, you know, people think they can go whitewater rafting down the street. You know, that's not something you want to do. You want to stay out of the floodwaters at all costs.
Yeah, not the greatest of ideas. And again, like I mentioned, my examples with Irene is that there were people swimming. There were people walking in the water. There were people, I don't know what else was going on, but not the smartest thing to do with that kind of water. Again, because you don't know what's in the water.
Correct.
For the hazards we already mentioned, and from the biological standpoint, from, you know, bacteria and stuff like that, you know, it gets a little tough to try to figure out what's actually going to be in the water. So don't want to recreate friends, any kind of a situation with flooding. Now, if I see something on my way to my safe area and it looks like either a wire down or there's some other flooding that's, you know, down the street from me, or there's a home on fire or whatever, what's your suggestion for that? Definitely call it in, regardless of whether you think it may have been called in already.
Yeah, if you're concerned that it may be an emergency, 100% call it in. You know, you can call 911, you can call one of the non-emergency numbers through the fire department or the police department. But do not assume that an incident has been reported, because a lot of times everyone just assumes that it's been reported, and then these incidents go unreported, and then that just delays their response, getting the necessary resources, or securing that area, whatever, you know, incident's going on.
Now, you mentioned securing the area. It's also important to heed those warnings with the tape, to not go into an active zone, because you're not, you know, you don't know what the active threat is, whether it's a wire that could fall down, could be a tree that you can't see, that, but you have been able to locate that part of a branch potentially is going to break off. To stay safe and just stay, give the first responders their distance in those active zones.
Yeah, that's correct. So there's always a reason why we have an area barricaded. We only have so many resources, personnel, apparatus that we can leave at scene during a flood or a storm. Mm-hmm. We're going to be running all over the town. So we'll use barricades, caution tape. So really, do not disregard any perimeter that is set up by emergency personnel. There is a reason why that's set up, and it's for your safety.
Mm-hmm. Now, we've all heard it over probably the last 20, 25 years. You know, if you see something, say something. I think it definitely applies here, like you said. If you see some sort of an issue with a wire down, trees down, flooding, house up, call it in. The folks here at the fire department are not going to be upset if you do call it in, or if it's the sixth person that's actually called it in. Just absolutely give that number a call, call it in, and make sure that you know, it is reported. Because like you said, there, you may not even know about it, because you could be spread thin throughout the town if it's a very, very large scale type event. So with that said, let's kind of summarize some of the points here for our video here today. The first one we mentioned was about securing your valuables, securing your home. So kind of just run through some of that for us.
Yeah, so we just mentioned being prepared, right? That's one of the biggest things, is being prepared, having your valuables in a designated area. So in the event you do have to evacuate or get those valuables to higher ground, it should be all in one area, in a bin, that you can move quickly. We talked about securing your lawn furniture, all your belongings in the backyard, all that stuff. You know, if floods come in, all that stuff's going for a ride. Mm-hmm. We talked about moving your vehicles to safe ground. You want to do that as early as possible, make sure it's parked legally and somewhere out of a flood zone. We also talked about the hazards associated with the flood water. Could be the manhole covers that become dislodged in the streets, down power lines. You might not see them if they do fall into flood water. Never assume that a hazard's been called in. If you come across a hazard, do not hesitate. You know, call 911 or the non-emergency number for the fire department or the police department. Mm-hmm.
And certainly don't want to recreate in any of the waters we just mentioned, about canoeing, boating, and whatever. Again, you just don't know what's actually in the water. There could be something that's hidden out of your view that could be an obstacle, could be anything. It could be, honestly, someone's lawn furniture that they didn't tie down, and it could end up in the middle of the street, or a garbage can. It could be anything.
Yeah,
that could potentially be a hazard for yourself if you happen to be inside of the water. So, Lieutenant Carmen Giordino, thanks a lot for all the great tips on how to secure your home, your safety, your personal property, even your pets too as well. Get them to higher ground, move those cars. And again, just the common sense as far as when the officials put out the word, either a Nixle or other alerts, to heed those warnings and get yourself to safety. Thanks a lot for joining us for this latest installment with our videos and our series of OEM videos. This will be on our TV35 YouTube channel and a playlist for OEM. Also, we posted to the emergency management website on the Cranford Township's website. That's CranfordNJ.org. Thanks so much for watching, everyone.